Well, in this last session of the KVBC evening meetings, I would like to express my thanks to the Trust, and especially to Paul Christie and the council of this church for opening up the premises like this. It makes it very convenient right in the heart of Penang, doesn't it, to come together in one well-appointed building, not only for the evening meetings, but for the conference we've had during the day. Now, to venture the book of Jeremiah in three nights is a bit of an impertinence. And obviously we haven't covered very much. The first night we looked at chapters 1, 2, and the first 5 verses of chapter 3. Last night we looked at the rest of 3 and 4. Now we're going to take a big jump. I should tell you, for those who are going to be here tomorrow morning, we'll look at chapter 31. This is the famous passage on the new covenant, which is quoted in the New Testament several times. And that's an important theme in the book of Jeremiah. But tonight, we're going to look at chapters 37, 38, and 39, which is a long narrative portion. And precisely because many of us don't know the Old Testament texts quite so well, I'm going to take the time to read it. I know this is a long section, but I think it will help us follow the flow if we take time to read these three chapters. So Jeremiah chapter 37, beginning at verse 1. Now, it might be helpful as I read to remind you of a couple of things. The northern tribes of Israel have gone into captivity quite a long time earlier, about 140 years earlier, under the mighty Assyrian army, about 721 BC. Now, this is just before Jerusalem falls and the south in 586 BC. It's just before that time. And the last king of Judah is King Zedekiah. So we are here right at the end of the history of the Old Testament kings before exile takes place. Hear then what Holy Scripture says. Zedekiah, son of Josiah, was made king of Judah by Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. That is, the king who was there was Jehoiachin, but he was captured and taken off into captivity to Babylon. And then the puppet king Zedekiah was put in place. That took place about 587. So we're now in these three chapters running from 587 to 586, from 597 rather, from 597 to 586, about an 11-year span covered in these three chapters. Neither he nor his attendants, nor the people of the land, paid any attention to the words the Lord had spoken through Jeremiah the prophet. King Zedekiah, however, sent Jehukal, son of Shelemiah, with the priest Zephaniah, son of Maaseiah, to Jeremiah the prophet with this message: "Please pray to the Lord our God for us." Now, Jeremiah was free to come and go among the people, for he had not yet been put in prison. Pharaoh's army had marched out of Egypt, and when the Babylonians who were besieging Jerusalem heard the report about them, they withdrew from Jerusalem. Then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet. "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Tell the king of Judah, who sent you to inquire of me, Pharaoh's army, which has marched out to support you, will go back to its own land, to Egypt. Then the Babylonians will return and attack this city. They will capture it and burn it down. This is what the Lord says. Do not deceive yourselves, thinking, 'The Babylonians will surely leave us.' They will not. Even if you were to defeat the entire Babylonian army that is attacking you, and only wounded men were left in their tents, they would come out and burn this city down." After the Babylonian army had withdrawn from Jerusalem because of Pharaoh's army, Jeremiah started to leave the city to go to the territory of Benjamin to get his share of the property among the people there. But when he reached the Benjamin gate, the captain of the guard, whose name was Irijah, son of Shelemiah, the son of Hananiah, arrested him and said, "You are deserting to the Babylonians." "That's not true," Jeremiah said. "I am not deserting to the Babylonians." But Irijah would not listen to him. Instead, he arrested Jeremiah and brought him to the officials. They were angry with Jeremiah and had him beaten and imprisoned in the house of Jonathan the secretary, which they had made into a prison. Jeremiah was put into a vaulted cell in a dungeon, where he remained a long time. Then King Zedekiah sent for him and had him brought to the palace, where he asked him privately, "Is there any word from the Lord?" "Yes," Jeremiah replied, "you will be delivered into the hands of the king of Babylon." Then Jeremiah said to King Zedekiah, "What crime have I committed against you or your attendants or this people that you have put me in prison? Where are your prophets who prophesied to you, 'The king of Babylon will not attack you or this land'? But now, my lord the king, please listen. Let me bring my petition before you. Do not send me back to the house of Jonathan the secretary, or I will die there." King Zedekiah then gave orders for Jeremiah to be placed in the courtyard of the guard and given a loaf of bread from the street of the bakers each day until all the bread in the city was gone. So Jeremiah remained in the courtyard of the guard. Shephatiah, son of Mattan, Gedaliah, son of Pashur, Jehukal, son of Shelemiah, and Pashur, son of Malchijah, heard what Jeremiah was telling all the people when he said, "This is what the Lord says. Whoever stays in this city will die by the sword, famine, or plague. But whoever goes over to the Babylonians will live. They will escape with their lives. They will live. This is what the Lord says. This city will certainly be given into the hands of the army of the king of Babylon, who will capture it." Then the official said to the king, "This man should be put to death. He is discouraging the soldiers who are left in this city, as well as all the people, by the things he is saying to them. This man is not seeking the good of these people, but their ruin." "He is in your hands," King Zedekiah answered. "The king can do nothing to oppose you." So they took Jeremiah and put him into the cistern of Malchijah, the king's son, which was in the courtyard of the guard. They lowered Jeremiah by ropes into the cistern. He had no water in it, only mud. And Jeremiah sank down into the mud. But Ebed-Melech, a Cushite, an official in the royal palace, heard that they had put Jeremiah into the cistern. While the king was sitting in the Benjamin gate, Ebed-Melech went out to the palace and said to him, "My lord the king, these men have acted wickedly in all they have done to Jeremiah the prophet. They have thrown him into a cistern, where he will starve to death when there is no longer any bread in the city." Then the king commanded Ebed-Melech the Cushite, "Take 30 men here with you and lift Jeremiah the prophet out of the cistern before he dies." So Ebed-Melech took the men with him and went to a room under the treasury in the palace. He took some old rags and worn out clothes from there and let them down with ropes to Jeremiah in the cistern. Ebed-Melech the Cushite said to Jeremiah, "Put these old rags and worn out clothes under your arms to pad the ropes." Jeremiah did so, and they pulled him up with the ropes and lifted him out of the cistern. And Jeremiah remained in the courtyard of the guard. Then King Zedekiah sent for Jeremiah the prophet and had him brought to the third entrance to the temple of the Lord. "I am going to ask you something," the king said to Jeremiah. "Do not hide anything from me." Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, "If I give you an answer, will you not kill me? Even if I did give you counsel, you would not listen to me." But King Zedekiah swore this oath secretly to Jeremiah, "As surely as the Lord lives, who has given us breath, I will neither kill you nor hand you over to those who want to kill you." Then Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, "This is what the Lord God Almighty, the God of Israel, says. If you surrender to the officers of the king of Babylon, your life will be spared, and this city will not be burned down. You and your family will live. But if you will not surrender to the officers of the king of Babylon, this city will be given into the hands of the Babylonians, and they will burn it down. You yourself will not escape from them." King Zedekiah said to Jeremiah, "I am afraid of the Jews who have gone over to the Babylonians, for the Babylonians may hand me over to them and they will mistreat me." "They will not hand you over," Jeremiah replied. "Obey the Lord by doing what I tell you. Then it will go well with you and your life will be spared. But if you refuse to surrender, this is what the Lord has revealed to me. All the women left in the palace of the king of Judah will be brought out to the officials of the king of Babylon. Those women will say to you, 'They misled you and overcame you, those trusted friends of yours. Your feet are sunk in the mud. Your friends have deserted you.' All your wives and children will be brought out to the Babylonians. You yourself will not escape from their hands, but will be captured by the king of Babylon, and this city will be burned down." Then Zedekiah said to Jeremiah, "Do not let anyone know about this conversation, or you may die. If the officials hear that I talked with you, and they come to you and say, 'Tell us what you said to the king, and what the king said to you,' do not hide it from us, or we will kill you. Then tell them, 'I was pleading with the king not to send me back to Jonathan's house to die there.'" All the officials did come to Jeremiah and question him, and he told them everything the king had ordered him to say. So they said no more to him, for no one had heard his conversation with the king. Then Jeremiah remained in the courtyard of the guard until the day Jerusalem was captured. This is how Jerusalem was taken. In the 9th year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, in the 10th month, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, marched against Jerusalem with his whole army and laid siege to it. And on the 9th day of the 4th month of Zedekiah's 11th year, the city wall was broken through. Then all the officials of the king of Babylon came and took seats in the middle gate. Nergal-shar-ezer of Samgar, Nebo-sarsekim, a chief officer, Nergal-shar-ezer, a high official, and all the other officials of the king of Babylon. When Zedekiah, king of Judah, and all the soldiers saw them, they fled. They left the city at night by way of the king's garden, through the gate between the two walls, and headed toward the Arabah. But the Babylonian army pursued them and overtook Zedekiah in the plains of Jericho. They captured him and took him to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, at Riblah in the land of Hamat, where he pronounced sentence on him. There, at Riblah, the king of Babylon slaughtered the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes and also killed all the nobles of Judah. Then he put out Zedekiah's eyes and bound him with bronze shackles to take him to Babylon. The Babylonians set fire to the royal palace and the houses of the people and broke down the walls of Jerusalem. Nebuzaradan, commander of the imperial guard, carried into exile to Babylon the people who remained in the city, along with those who had gone over to him and the rest of the people. But Nebuzaradan, the commander of the guard, left behind in the land of Judah some of the poor people who owned nothing, and at that time he gave them vineyards and fields. Now, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had given these orders about Jeremiah through Nebuzaradan, commander of the imperial guard. Take him and look after him. Don't harm him, but do for him whatever he asks. So Nebuzaradan, the commander of the guard, Nebushazban, a chief official, Nergal Sharezer, a high official, and all the other officers of the king of Babylon sent and had Jeremiah taken out of the courtyard of the guard. They turned him over to Gedaliah, son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, to take him back to his home. So he remained among his own people. While Jeremiah had been confined in the courtyard of the guard, the word of the Lord came to him. Go and tell Ebed-Melech the Cushite, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. I am about to fulfill my words against this city, words concerning disaster, not prosperity. At that time they will be fulfilled before your eyes. But I will rescue you on that day, declares the Lord. You will not be given into the hands of those you fear. I will save you. You will not fall by the sword, but you will escape with your life because you trust in me, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Now, in this section, then, we turn to a passage, a block of material that is full of narrative. In part, it relates to the fall of Jerusalem. But what we'll do is focus on this account of Jerusalem's fall, for in reality, it tells us much more than that. It also tells us how Jeremiah is treated, how Zedekiah listens to the word of the Lord yet doesn't follow it, how even at this late stage, he has an opportunity to repent and doesn't take it, and the reasoning of God himself as judgment is pronounced. I think it best to begin by making sure we have the narrative straight in our minds, and then we'll think through some larger theological and pastoral applications for us today. This block of three chapters, 37, 38, 39, is structured by three private interviews between Zedekiah the king and Jerusalem. Zedekiah, the last king of Jerusalem, and these three blocks of interviews are interspersed with the beatings and imprisonment of Jeremiah as the officials ignore what he has to say and call for his demise. Now let me remind you of the setting. Chapter 37, verse 1. Zedekiah, son of Josiah, was made king of Judah by Nebuchadnezzar. There had been various movements back and forth as the Babylonians became stronger and stronger and stronger until they were at Jerusalem's gates again, threatening a takeover. The only power that had any strength left to threaten the Babylonians was the Egyptians farther down in the south. And in fact, Zedekiah, against the word of the Lord, had tried to position Judah with the Egyptians again. And that's one of the reasons why Nebuchadnezzar was now on the doorstep of Jerusalem, trying to threaten it one more time and bring them into line with the Babylonians. Now, eventually, in 597, Jehoiachin, who was the king, Jehoiachin was captured and was taken off as a kind of hostage for good behavior to Babylon. And he was replaced by Zedekiah, his uncle, who was also thus a son of Josiah, the last good king a few years earlier. So he was a puppet king installed by Nebuchadnezzar, the mighty imperial monarch in Babylon. But sadly, we read 37:2, neither he nor his attendants nor the people of the land paid any attention to the words of the Lord which had been spoken through Jeremiah the prophet. In other words, there are times when God raises up prophets, when God raises up preachers, and people just don't listen to them. That's true in the life of Isaiah. And it's true in the life of Jeremiah, which is one of the reasons why he's sometimes called the weeping prophet. And in other cases, some people listen and some people don't. That was true in the life of Jesus. He could have vast crowds listening to him. But he himself could also say, because I tell so many people the truth, they do not listen. In other words, it's precisely the truth that blinds people, that deafens them on occasion. Because I tell you the truth, you do not believe. And many of the crowds that listened to Jesus also were among the crowds that would shortly cry, crucify him, crucify him. Crowds can be fickle things. So that's the background of the setting here. We're in the final stages of the siege. It begins in 588 BC as the mighty imperial army of Babylon encircles Jerusalem. Meanwhile, farther south in Egypt, Pharaoh Hofra, he begins to move his troops up to Egypt. And Jerusalem thinks it's going to get saved because of it. And because the troops are coming up to Jerusalem from the south to fight the Babylonians, Nebuchadnezzar removes some of his troops from Jerusalem in order to turn left and head down south and attack the Egyptians. And eventually the Egyptians have no strength at all, and then the Babylonian army comes back and completes the siege of Jerusalem, and Jerusalem falls in 586 BC. That's all background. So, let me outline the drama of these three chapters in six steps, and then we'll think through what it means to understand this part of the Word of God. Number one, the first interview with King Zedekiah, verses 3 to 10. The first interview with King Zedekiah. What Zedekiah does, even though verse 2 tells us that he really doesn't pay much attention to the word of the Lord, nor to his attendants, nor do the people as a whole, yet nevertheless what he does in verse 3 is, through various messengers, send a secret message to Jeremiah the prophet, saying, we're being encircled by enemies here. Pray for us. Is there some word from the Lord? What can you tell us? Do you see, even people who are the most amazing renegades can sometimes get real spiritual when they're in foxholes. When they see that they're in trouble, then they might turn to the Lord. They never pray, but now when they're in trouble and they don't see a way out, then they want an answer from God. They're not really interested in holiness. They're not really interested in serving God. They don't pay attention to what Jeremiah says, but now they consult Jeremiah in the hope that Jeremiah will say something acceptable and encouraging and warm-hearted, sentimental, fuzzy. But the word of the Lord comes to Jeremiah the prophet, and he delivers it faithfully in verse 7. Tell the king of Judah who sent you to inquire of me, Pharaoh's army, which has marched out to support you, will go back to its own land, to Egypt. There's no hope there. Don't think that you're going to get away with things because Pharaoh is starting off to attack Babylon. In fact, the Babylonians are going to beat Egypt, and then they'll return, verse 8, and attack this city, and they will capture it and burn it down. So, verse 9, don't kid yourselves. Do not deceive yourselves thinking the Babylonians will surely leave us. They will not. And even if somehow you were to defeat the mighty Babylonian army, which was a ridiculous thing, a few thousand Jewish troops compared with hundreds of thousands of Babylonian troops, there was complete disparity in size and power. It's as if a little country like Pongo Pongo took on the military might of the United States, you know? And then even if Pongo Pongo could destroy the military might of the United States, the fact of the matter is, this text says, the mighty Babylonian army, what's left of it, even if it's only a bunch of cripples in tents, they're still going to tear this city down. God has decreed this city is going to be destroyed. That's the first interview with King Zedekiah. Then second, verses 11 to 16, the officials arrest and beat Jeremiah. Jeremiah, while the Babylonian troops are off a little farther south, tackling the Egyptians, he leaves and heads up to Anathoth, where he has the family residence, a few miles north of Jerusalem. That's where he's from. He's a priest from Anathoth, if you recall from two nights ago, when we saw in the opening verses of chapter 1 and he was identified. So he's up there getting some family goods somehow. We don't know exactly what. That's what he wants to do. But he's stopped at the gate as he leaves the city. Apparently, they think he is deserting to the Romans, to the Babylonians, and he's imprisoned in an underground dungeon in a scribe's house that has been converted into a prison. That's what takes place in verses 11 to 16. So not only do they not believe him when he's telling the word of the Lord, they don't believe him when he's just explaining his ordinary movements back and forth. They just don't believe him at all. Some wag has said that one of the punishments of a liar is not that he's not believed, but that he does not believe. You see, these people can detect lies everywhere because they're a bunch of liars themselves. It's so often the way, isn't it? The book of Proverbs says as much. But while he's in prison, you come to the third block of material. The second interview with King Zedekiah, chapter 37, verses 17 to 21. Now, the first time, the interview between Zedekiah and Jeremiah was conducted through the emissaries that he sent. But this time, it's a personal interview. Zedekiah arranges to have the prisoner, Jeremiah, brought secretly into the palace, privately. At this point, Zedekiah is still a young man, about 32 years old. Jeremiah the prophet is about 60 years old. After more than 40 years of ministry, he began, if you recall, as a teenager. And the outcome is very much the same. We read that Zedekiah sends for him and asks, hesitantly, hopefully, naively, is there any word from the Lord? Verse 17, yes, Jeremiah replies, you will be delivered into the hands of the king of Babylon. Do not think that the Babylonians are not coming back. God has ordained destruction for this city. And before Zedekiah has the chance to say anything more, Jeremiah says, and while I've got your attention, I've got a private request to make. After all, what crime have I done? I'm not a rapist. I'm not a thief. I'm not a murderer. I haven't cheated on my taxes. I haven't rebelled against the king. Why am I in prison? I'm in prison because some of your officials think that I'm a traitor, but I haven't betrayed anybody. I've merely spoken the word of the Lord. Where are your prophets who predicted that the Babylonians wouldn't even come? By now you should realize there is a difference between the false prophets and me, the prophet of the Lord. Why aren't they in prison? They've told you lies. They've corrupted imperial policy. But I'm the one that's in prison and I've told you the truth. Can't you see that it's the truth? Where are your prophets who prophesied to you the king of Babylon will not attack you or this land? So at very least, I implore you, my lord the king, verse 20, please listen to my petition. Don't send me back to that underground prison, or I'll simply die there. Now, King Zedekiah turns out to be a weak man. He's not very courageous. He's two-faced. He listens to one party, then he listens to another party. And he's afraid of his own attendants. But at this point, he has enough strength and gives the orders that Jeremiah should be placed in the courtyard of the guard, above ground now, no longer in an underground vault, getting some fresh air, and with orders to give him some bread every day from the street of the bakers, as long as there's still bread in the city, because with a siege going on, eventually the bread will run out. So Jeremiah remains in the courtyard of the guard. That's the end of chapter 3. Zedekiah is exposed as an ambivalent and weak man. Then, chapter 38, verses 1 to 13, the fourth section. The officials arrange to kill Jeremiah. Apparently, Jeremiah is still able to speak to the people, whether in this courtyard of the guard or through messengers that go back and forth. We don't know. But in verses 2 and 3, he is still speaking the message that God has given him to speak. This is what the Lord says, verse 2. And this he says to the citizens of the city. Whoever stays in this city will die by the sword, famine, or plague, but whoever goes over to the Babylonians will live. In other words, he's openly telling the citizens of the city that they should get out now and surrender. And if they surrender, they may go off into captivity, but at least they'll live. But if they don't surrender, God is so determined to crush this city that they need to understand as the siege gets worse, there'll be famine. As the siege gets worse and there's famine and people fall sick, there'll be pestilence. And when the city finally falls, there'll be sword, there'll be death. One way or the other, if you stay in this city, you die. So Jeremiah, partly because he's speaking the word of truth from God, he's telling the truth, and partly out of compassion for these people whom he doesn't want to die, tells them that the right thing to do in this case is to get out and surrender. But the officials see that as giving in, weakening the backbone of the remaining defenders of the city. So they think that Jeremiah's got to go. Instead of just quietening him down, they could have put him in some place where he no longer has any access to the people. They could have done that. But instead, they say, he's got to die. So they go to the king and they insist that something be done about Jeremiah. This king Zedekiah, who has twice sought Jeremiah's opinion, but is such a weak-kneed, two-faced man, says in verse 5, he's in your hands, nothing I can do. The king can do nothing to oppose you. So they take him to the cistern of Malchijah. Now you must understand that Malchijah was one of the sons of Zedekiah. So one of Zedekiah's own sons wants Jeremiah, the prophet, dead. And he's got some abandoned well in his property that is now no longer a source of water, but has feet of mud in it, deep. They lower Jeremiah with ropes into this cistern, and we're told that he sinks down in the mud. They're going to leave him there. No food, no fresh air. He's just going to starve to death in the mud. But now we're introduced to another young man, Ebed-Melech. Ebed-Melech means in Hebrew, servant of the king. This may not even be his name. It may be that that's what he was called. Hey, servant of the king, Ebed-Melech. He's a Cushite, we're told. That is, he's from what was then called Ethiopia, which is not exactly the same as our Ethiopia, but the Upper Nile area. It overlapped a bit with modern Ethiopia in East Africa. And he was probably a black-skinned man from Africa, and he's the servant of the king. He's Ebed-Melech. And he sees what's going on in Jeremiah's life, and he knows it's not right, it's not fair, it's not honest, it's not good, it's not healthy. So he goes and reports it all to the king. After all, he's a servant of the king. He's got access to him in some ways. My lord the king, these men have acted wickedly. And so he explains they've thrown him into a cistern where he will starve to death when there is no longer any bread in the city. So instead of the king saying, wow, these wicked men who are doing this sort of thing, I'll stop them. I'll put an end to that. After all, one of the wicked men who was doing it was his own son, Malchijah. But this king doesn't have enough backbone even to keep his own son under control. So what he does is tell Ebed-Melech, go and round up 30 guys. With 30 guys, you'll be able to handle it and pull him out of the cistern. So he gets ropes, not only ropes, but cloths and cloaks and so on, because he realizes that this man is sunk so deeply into the mud. It must have been very deeply into the mud. He may have been up to his waist or his shoulders or his neck for Ebed-Melech to feel it's necessary to do what he does. He wants Jeremiah to wrap these rags and clothes and cloaks under his arms so that when the ropes press up, they won't literally pull his arms up. There's going to be suction as they pull him out of the mud, you see. He's in so deep. But gradually they get him out, they pull him up, and then Jeremiah remains in the courtyard of the guard, presumably protected at this point by Ebed-Melech and his 30 men. And then there is a third interview. This is the fifth section. The third interview with King Zedekiah, chapter 38, verses 14 to 28. King Zedekiah sent for Jeremiah again. He has him brought to the third entrance of the temple. We don't know quite where that was, but probably it's a way of saying, not the main entrance, the third entrance, sneak him in the back door. This time not at the palace, maybe at the temple. Sneak him in a side door, the third entrance, and maybe we can have a private conversation there. I'm going to ask you again, he says. Is there any word from the Lord? Don't hide anything from me. How is this going to turn out? It's as if this king is wimping back and forth between opinions. Will I listen to Jeremiah? Will I not? What's the best thing to do? I don't really know. I'm confused. And he calls for Jeremiah again. This Jeremiah, whom he was prepared to let die not that long ago at the hand of Malchijah, when his own attendants had asked permission to do something about him. And then he had wiffle-waffled the other way and arranged for Ebed-Melech to pull him out. Now he goes back to asking Jeremiah again, what does God actually say? And Jeremiah says to Zedekiah, Jeremiah's getting tired of this, you know. He says, if I give you an answer, will you just kill me? And even if I do give you counsel, you won't listen to me anyway. You have a track record of not listening. What's the point of giving you an answer? But King Zedekiah swears an oath. Not an oath that he will do what Jeremiah says, but at least he swears an oath secretly. He can't even make it a public policy. Secretly. That I won't kill you, and I won't hand you over to those who do want to kill you. So Jeremiah speaks the word of God. This is what the Lord God Almighty, the God of Israel, says. If you surrender to the officers of the king of Babylon, your life will be spared, and this city will not be burned down. You and your family will live. If Jeremiah is telling the truth, that's the best policy. It may be heroic on some occasions to go down with a ship, but at this point, it means not only his own death, but the death of his family as well. All of his sons will be killed. Not only so, but if we read down a little further, verse 22, from 21, if you refuse to surrender, this is what the Lord has revealed to me. 22, all the women left in the palace of the king of Judah will be brought out to the officials of the king of Babylon. Now you must understand what that means. The women left in the palace are the harem. They're Zedekiah's wives. They're going to be brought out and gang raped by the troops from Nebuchadnezzar. You must understand that if you stay here, that's what's going to happen. It's on your head. If you disobey the word of God, you're condemning your own children to death and your wives to gang rape. That's what is being told Zedekiah. And the women will, in effect, say to you, your advisors misled you. They led you astray. And the result is we're getting raped. Verse 23, all your wives and children will be brought out to the Babylonians, and you yourself will not escape from their hands, but will be captured by the king of Babylon. And meanwhile, this city, far from being preserved, it'll be burned to the ground. That's what's going to happen. And Jeremiah speaks the word of God courageously, while Zedekiah, verse 19, says, I'm scared. He's scared of his own son. He's scared of his own attendants. He's scared to do the right thing. And now he's scared of the Jews who've already gone over to the Babylonians. afraid that if he goes over to the Babylonians himself, they'll beat him up or something. And Jeremiah says that the Babylonians won't hand you over to them. Do the right thing. This is what God has revealed. How can you be trusting your own prophets? Your own prophets have been wrong again and again and again. Hear the word of the Lord, don't you see? There's a pattern here. And then finally we come to the fall of Jerusalem. The details are pretty straightforward. Zedekiah tells Jeremiah, don't tell anybody about this. Don't tell anybody about this, which shows that he really isn't committed to doing the right thing, because if he does the right thing, it would inevitably be a public action. He still wants it all sub rosa. He wants it confidential. He wants it quiet. And so this is how Jerusalem was taken, chapter 39. There's a bit of a review. In the ninth year of Zedekiah, that's about 588 BC, King Nebuchadnezzar comes and surrounds Jerusalem. And then in the 11th year, the end of verse 2, that is in 586, the city wall is broken through. And in that two-year span, for a while, the Babylonian troops have gone south toward Egypt to cut off Pharaoh Hophra, and then they've come back and they've surrounded the city. And when it's clear that the wall is about to be broken through, the officials of the king of Babylon, they come and take seats in the middle gate. Their names are provided. And Zedekiah, for his part, they try to flee. They sneak out through the king's garden, a dark path, maybe an underground watering channel, I don't know. We're told that they head out toward the Arabah. That's that long valley that embraces the Jordan River and then the Dead Sea and farther south, a long, steep, deep valley. They're heading to the Arabah, hoping they can turn then either left, north toward Galilee, or south toward the desert and flee and get away. It's about 17 miles away if they head down toward Jericho. But fast Babylonian troops overtake Zedekiah on the plains of Jericho. They capture him. They take him to Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar, the mighty imperial monarch of Babylon, is not even in Jerusalem at this point. Nebuzaradan and his own troops are there doing the work for him. He himself is a few miles away at the city of Ribla. There at Ribla, the king of Babylon takes all the sons of Zedekiah, and in front of Zedekiah, as he watches, he kills them one by one till they're all gone. Because that's a way of saying, that's the end of this dynasty. There's no hope for you. No dynasty. This is the end of the line. Of course, you know and I know, because we've read the book of Jeremiah, that it's not the end of the Davidic dynasty, because the real king, not the puppet king, is Jehoiakim. He's already been captured by the Babylonians and is already living in Babylon. Do you see? Zedekiah was just the puppet king who was installed. So Jehoiakim is still there. He is preserving the messianic Davidic line. But meanwhile, Zedekiah loses all of his own sons. Not only his own sons, but the aristocracy of the city, what's left of it, the nobles of Jerusalem. And they're lined up in front of Zedekiah, and he watches them all killed because of his own stupid, malicious mistakes. And then, once he's seen all of that, the soldiers come up to Zedekiah and put their thumbs in their eyes and just pluck out his eyes. So the last thing he sees is the destruction of his family. Then they bind him in bronze shackles and take him to Babylon, where he dies. That's the end of him. Then the Babylonians set fire to the royal palace. If you go back to the days of David, when that was built, it was a royal palace largely built of cedar, so it would have burned magnificently. They burn down anything that's burnable. And then they send in thousands and thousands and thousands of troops and start tearing down the wall, pulling out the stones one by one, throwing them down, throwing them down, throwing them down. But mercifully, Jeremiah's life is at this point still saved. And God remembers Ebed-Melech too, for the fact that he feared the Lord, and God looks after him. Now, I didn't press on to read chapters 40 to 44. Be of good cheer. I'm not going to expound all of those chapters, but let me summarize what happens next. The imperial Babylonian government appoints a governor, a local governor, over the poor of the land who are left behind. His name is Gedaliah. But some of the Jews that are left think, yeah, Gedaliah is just a puppet from Babylon. So they kill him too. They try to rope Jeremiah into this, and Jeremiah says, no, don't. All that's going to do is bring more wrath down upon our heads. God has ordained that we will be ruled for the time being by the Babylonians. Leave Gedaliah in place. But again, they don't listen, and they kill Gedaliah. And then they stop and think, and they say, that could get us into real trouble. Maybe the troops of Babylon will come back because we murdered their appointed governor. And so they ask Jeremiah, what does the Lord say? Jeremiah says, will you listen if I tell you? Oh yes, we'll listen. We want to do the right thing this time. Whatever you say, we'll do. So Jeremiah seeks the face of God, and for 10 days, no answer is given by God, and then God speaks after 10 days. And what God says is, stay in Jerusalem. Stay in Jerusalem. Tough this one out. Wait. You won't be killed if you stay in Jerusalem. Wait. And when he gives this word from the Lord, the people don't listen to that either. They say, that's far too dangerous. We're going to go down to Egypt. We're just going to abandon the city entirely and head toward Egypt. Jeremiah says, I want to stay here. They say, you've got no choice in the matter. And they haul Jeremiah down to Egypt as well. And then when they get down to Egypt, God speaks through Jeremiah to the people once again. And what he says, in effect, is, hear the word of the Lord. It won't be very long before Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian troops set up their throne right down here, and they'll come after you again. And that's the way the book ends. So right to the end of his ministry, the majority of the people in power, don't listen to Jeremiah. Now, you have to remember that through the book, there have been some signs of hope just the same. We haven't seen many of them because we've only focused on a few chapters here and there. The best sign of hope is that there is an announcement of a new covenant that's going to dawn. Yes, the people are living under the old covenant, the Mosaic covenant, but a new covenant is coming that is spectacular. We'll worry about that tomorrow morning. But also, Jeremiah gives some other prophecies of things that are going to happen sooner. The people will return to the land. After about 70 years, they will be permitted to come back to the land. In other words, God's wrath will not last forever. There is hope for the people of Israel. They will come back to the land. And there are little snippets of those sorts of things as well throughout the prophecy of Jeremiah. But by and large, it's a bleak book. Now then, what are some lessons we should learn at this stage? Number one, there is nothing more tragic and more damning than a refusal to listen attentively, faithfully, and obediently to the Word of God. There is nothing worse. There is nothing more tragic and more damning. Did you see, it's possible to listen to the Word of God in a superficial sort of way, to be a nominal believer. In a sense, Zedekiah was a nominal believer. He believed enough to want to keep asking questions from, what does the Bible say? What does God say? Is there any hope? Is there any encouragement? In one sense, he was a nominal believer. He hadn't abandoned completely the Word of God. He wanted to hear it. But there was no genuine faithfulness. There was no genuine obedience. There was no genuine courage. So there are some people who likewise like to go to church and hear encouraging little Christianette sermons for Christianettes, sermonettes for Christianettes. Did you know? Little bits of encouragement here and there. But they don't want to live by the Word of God, because that would change their lifestyle. It would change their priorities. It would change the way they spend their money. It would change what they do with their time. And they don't really want to follow. They don't have a heart for God. And there is nothing more sad. This whole book is full of depictions of people like that. Now, in fact, it's worth drawing a parallel between chapter 36, which we haven't read, and chapter 37, which we did read. Now, I'm not going back to chapter 36 either, but let me remind you what happens there. It happens during an earlier period under King Jehoiakim. That's the king before Jehoiakim, who was the king before Zedekiah. In other words, sometimes Jeremiah arranges his book topically so that you can see topical patterns, theological patterns, rather than mere chronology. And under the time of Jehoiakim, then some things happen which are very parallel to the things that happen in chapter 37. Let me show you the parallels. My left hand is chapter 36. My right hand is chapter 37. We've just read chapter 37. We know what happens there. Left hand is chapter 36, all right? Chapter 36, King Jehoiakim. Chapter 37, King Zedekiah. Chapter 36, the siege of Ashkelon. The city of Ashkelon in Judah is being besieged. That takes place in 598, 12 years earlier. And in chapter 37, the siege of Jerusalem from 588 to 586. Chapter 36, God's word is read very carefully to the people. Chapter 37, God's word is delivered again as an oracle to the king. Chapter 36, the officials who hear God's word, they say, this is important message. We ought to take the message to the king. They respond positively. Chapter 37, the officials, when they hear the message from God, they don't even respond positively anymore. They want to bump Jeremiah off. Chapter 36. In chapter 36, when the king finally hears the word of the Lord from the officials, he's the one that doesn't listen. He just doesn't listen. And what he does instead is he takes this accumulated scripture, the words of the oracles of Jeremiah, and he takes the scroll and he starts tearing off a sheet as it's read to him and dumping it in the fire. It's like tearing pages out of your Bible, dumping it in the fire. I don't like what this says, rip, in the fire. So the next page is read. I don't like what that says either, rip, dump it in the fire. I don't like what that says either, rip, turn it in the fire. So all of these oracles that are warning the people of God against what will happen unless they repent, King Jehoiakim says, I don't like that. I don't like that. This is what I think of your prophecies, and you're a false prophet. I don't believe a word you say. Rip up another sheet, drop it in the fire. Rip up another sheet and drop it in the fire. As if you can destroy the word of God by dropping off pages of written text in the fire. And you know, as you read this, do you know what you're supposed to be doing? On the one hand, you're supposed to be shocked that somebody would treat the word of God like that. But there's another part of you that's supposed to be laughing your head off. Do you know why? If this really is the word of God, do you think that God has forgotten what he said? God's memory is better than that of any tape recorder. God knows what he says. And so what we discover is that all of the words of God are given to Jeremiah again, and Jeremiah dictates them to Baruch, and Baruch's got to write them down again. The only person who's seriously inconvenienced is dear old Baruch, who's got to write it all down again. Do you see? So on the one hand, it's tragic that Zedekiah could be so stupid with the word of God. And on the other hand, it's a bit laughable that he thinks that he can destroy the Word of God by burning up a manuscript. That's chapter 36. Chapter 37, the king hears the words, but he refuses to listen too. So King Jehoiakim in chapter 36, he tries to destroy the message by burning the manuscript. In chapter 37, King Zedekiah doesn't want to listen, at one point actually tries to destroy the messenger. And all of this to show that the people in power are not listening to the Word of God. Now compare that with what is said in a passage like Deuteronomy chapter 17. This is at the time of Moses. This is before there's any king in Jerusalem. Before there's any king at all, the people have still not entered into the promised land. But Moses in Deuteronomy 17 looks forward to the time when there will be a king. And he says, let me tell you what the king's supposed to be like. Deuteronomy 17, verses 14 and following. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you and have taken possession of it and settled in it, and you say, let us set a king over us like all the nations around us, be sure to appoint over you a king the Lord your God chooses. He must be from among your fellow Israelites, not a foreigner. He must be a genuine, true blue covenant child. Do not place a foreigner over you, one who is not an Israelite. The king, moreover, must not acquire great numbers of horses for himself. That is, read tanks. These are war horses. So he's not to build up a whopping big military as if that's going to save him. Or make the people return to Egypt to get more of them. He's not to enter into allegiances with the regional superpowers. For the Lord has told you, you are not to go back this way again. He must not take many wives. Think King Solomon. Sometimes having many wives was just lust. But sometimes it was a desire to make alliances with the surrounding pagan kings. And all of those women who were Solomon's wives had their own pagan deities. And pretty soon, Solomon was filling Jerusalem with pagan temples in order to keep his many wives happy. And he must not accumulate large amounts of silver and gold. So he's not to attract to himself the power of alliances with many kings, the power of having super tanks, the power of having filthy wealth. The rulers aren't supposed to be like that, we're told. And it seems to me that there are a lot of rulers today who still are trying to accumulate for themselves a lot of silver and gold. It's not completely unknown, I suspect. No, what is he supposed to do? What's his task? What's he supposed to do? When he takes the throne of his kingdom, we're told, he is to write for himself on a scroll a copy of this law taken from that of the Levitical priests. So, what this law refers to might be the whole Pentateuch. It might be the book of Deuteronomy or some part of it. But what's the first thing he's supposed to do when he comes to the throne? Is he supposed to audit the books of his predecessor? Nope. Is he supposed to appoint a minister of war? Nope. Appoint a secretary of state? Nope. Make sure the cabinet's properly installed? Nope. The first thing he's supposed to do is take out his stylus and copy out by hand a copy of Scripture. Don't forget, there were no photocopy machines. It wasn't a case of downloading something from the cloud onto your hard drive without it passing through anybody's brain. No, it's going to pass through his brain, all right. He's got to copy it out, longhand. And he's got to do it so carefully and so slowly and in such good printing that that becomes his reading copy. Do you see what it says? It is to be with him, this copy, and he is to read it all the days of his life. That's to become his reading copy for his personal devotions. That's his Bible for devotional reading, all the days of his life from that point on. That's the first thing he's supposed to do as king. He's to do this so that he may learn to revere the Lord his God and follow carefully all the words of this law and these decrees and not consider himself better than his fellow Israelites and turn from the law to the right or to the left. Then he and his descendants will reign a long time over his kingdom in Israel. If those seven verses, just those seven verses from Deuteronomy, had been obeyed, all of Old Testament history would have been different. But here you find, after the kingdoms have been split, the northern tribes have headed off into paganism and then into captivity, into exile. The southern kingdom, even the Davidic line itself, sunk into miasmic blindness, cannot see straight, still not listening to the word of God, still not reading scripture. At one point, in fact, the scriptures are lost. Under Josiah's ministry, he starts a reformation because they found one more copy at last, hidden away in some dark corner of the temple, which kicks off another round of reformation again. It's terrible. They have not cherished the word of God. And now when the word of God does come to Zedekiah through the prophet Jeremiah, very little attention is being paid. Do you realize how important this is in scripture? When Jesus, on the night that he is betrayed, prays for his disciples, he says to his heavenly Father, sanctify them through your truth. Your word is truth. Do you want to preserve the church and strengthen the church in this country? Do you want to? Then the first and most important thing you must do is to read and reread and reread and reread and teach the Word of God so we learn to think God's thoughts after Him. What is Joshua told when he takes over the leadership from Moses, leads the people into the promised land? This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night. Then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. Do you see the importance of the Word of God at every level, again and again and again? So let me repeat this first point. It is extremely important. There is nothing more tragic and more damning than a refusal to listen attentively, faithfully, and obediently to the Word of God. Number two, God is amazingly long-suffering. He is patient. He is slow to anger. But judgment comes in the end. God is amazingly long-suffering. He is patient. He is slow to anger. But judgment comes in the end. After all, Jeremiah's ministry has been going on for more than 40 years. And indeed, predictions were already being made in the time of Isaiah, almost a century and a half earlier, that Jerusalem was going to fall unless there was repentance. God could have wiped them out right away at the first sign of idolatry. God is amazingly patient. But judgment comes at the end. Brothers and sisters in Christ, there are many, many, many people who think that as God presents himself in the Old Testament, he's meaner, harsher, more severe than the way God presents himself in the New Testament. Now, if you're a serious Christian, you know that can't be right. It's the same God. But do you not think sometimes, once in a while, boy, I'm sure glad I didn't live back then. Pestilence and famine and sword. Glad I didn't live back then. Now we've got gentle Jesus, meek and mild, look upon a little child, turn the other cheek and love your enemy as yourself. Much, much nicer. Much, much more comfortable. Don't we think that sometimes? Well, we're not quite so crass as to put it that way, but doesn't it seem sometimes as if maybe God has become a little more mellow, maybe? A little softer when you turn to the new covenant? And there's a part of you deep down that says that can't be right, and yet, you know, it does seem like that now and then, doesn't it? I have to tell you, nothing could be farther from the truth. Because after all, it's the New Testament that speaks so much more about hell. And the person who says most about hell in the New Testament is Jesus. And indeed, some of the depictions of final judgment in the New Testament are spectacularly grim. Think of these verses from Revelation 14. Verse 17, another angel came out of the temple in heaven, and he too had a sharp sickle. Still another angel who had charge of the fire came from the altar and called in a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, "Take your sharp sickle, gather the clusters of grapes from the earth's vine, because its grapes are ripe." The angel swung his sickle on the earth, gathered its grapes, and threw them into the great winepress of God's wrath. They were trampled in the winepress outside the city, and blood flowed out of the press, rising as high as the horse's bridles for a distance of 1,600 stadia. Do you hear what that imagery is saying? You're in a vineyard with a great big stone vat. A big stone vat. At the bottom of the stone vat are holes with stone channels taking away the grape juice. And so you throw in the grapes. The servant girls come along and pick up their skirts and kick off their sandals and start tramping down the grapes. You tramp down the grapes. You tramp down the grapes. You tramp down the grapes. And the grape juice goes out those channels and goes into underground stone bottles until gradually they're filled, and you have these vats of grape juice, and that's what eventually becomes wine. And now this vat, this imagery, is the great winepress of God's wrath. And people are being trampled underfoot until their blood comes out and rises to the height of a horse's bridle for a distance of 200 miles. Now you look me in the face and tell me that the God of the New Testament is a softer God. You make all of the allowances you like for metaphor. This is horrific. And there are many passages like that in the New Testament. Do you know why some of us think that the depictions of judgment are softer in the New Testament? It's because we're so materialistic, we're more afraid of famine and war than we are of hell. That's the truth. But if you're more frightened of famine and war than you are of hell, then you're not taking Jesus seriously. He's the one who says most about hell. You see, it is simply not the case that as you move from the Old Testament to the New, you move from a stern God to a soft God. Do you know what really is the case? As you move from the Old Testament to the New, the depictions of God's love are ratcheted up, and the depictions of God's severity are ratcheted up. They're both ratcheted up. The depictions of God's love are ratcheted up until they meet their climax, their high point, their crescendo in the cross. Oh, God is depicted in the Old Testament as slow to anger, abundant in mercy, a merciful, long-suffering, patient God. But even more so in the New Testament, where his Son bears our sins in his own body on the tree. But likewise, the pictures of God's holiness and justice and ultimate severity are also ratcheted up, so that instead of merely temporal judgments, here there are ultimately final and eternal judgments. They're ratcheted up until you see that the options are finally heaven and hell. And indeed, in one sense, just as the pictures of God's love are ratcheted up until you come to the cross, the pictures of God's judgment are ratcheted up until you come to the cross. For there's a profound sense in which it's in the cross where you see the greatest depiction, both of God's love and of God's severe justice met in one person, in Christ's own body on the cross. God is amazingly long-suffering. He is patient, he is slow to anger, but judgment comes on the end. It comes on nations. It comes on individuals. There are lots of biblical stories to that effect. Like that of the rich man, for example, who says, "My barns are full. I will tear them down and build bigger barns." And God says, "You fool, this night your soul shall be required of you." And eventually that must be said to all of us. God is patient, but eventually it is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. And finally, judgment, however, is not the last word. Jeremiah points in so many, many ways to hope. He talks about the number of places, in a number of places, where the people will return to the promised land. And above all, he points to the new covenant. We'll study that more tomorrow, but under the terms of the new covenant, their sins will be wiped away. He will write their law in their hearts so that they will all know him, his own covenant people, from the least to the greatest. No long will a man say, "Know the Lord," they'll all know me. Envisaged is a new covenant community. The new covenant community sealed in Jesus' blood. For on the night that he goes to the cross, he says, "This is the blood of the new covenant, sealed for many, offered for many, for the forgiveness of sin." Indeed, one can almost say that there are some parallels between Jeremiah and Jesus. There is a sense in which Jeremiah is presented as the weeping prophet, and Jesus is presented as the man of sorrows, who's acquainted with grief. Jeremiah is presented as the one whose mouth is filled by the word of God. "My mouth was full of fire," such that Jeremiah almost himself becomes the word of God. And Jesus is the word of God, God's own self-expression. Jeremiah is systematically rejected. Jesus is systematically rejected. Jeremiah is brought before the authorities, who give him a hard time. Jesus is brought before the authorities. They give him a hard time too. But there is a number of differences. The most important is this. By the end of the account, even though Jeremiah is taken down to Egypt, basically he's vindicated. Everything that he said has come true. And he's left, as it were, to say, without him saying so, "I told you so." In other words, in Jeremiah, the guilty finally die, and Jeremiah is vindicated. But in Jesus, the innocent one is put to death, precisely so that the guilty may be vindicated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we confess that even the serious people in this room, serious or they would not be here at all, even we serious people in this room sometimes don't take your word as seriously as we should. We confess we live at a time when there is much love of consumer goods, much love of digital titillation, much love of power. We live at a time when there is fear in the land as to the future and uncertainty. But, O Lord God, we pray for one another whether here or anywhere else in the world, that your people will above all so be taken up by your most holy word, that they will be like those described by the prophet Isaiah. To these will I look, they who are humble and of a contrite spirit, and who tremble at my word. Forbid that we should be like Zedekiah, who want just enough Bible to give us some guidance, but do not want to tremble before the word of the living God. Give us instead hearts that understand and love and trust and obey your most holy word. Not as a sense of mere duty, we have to do it or we're damned, but as a sense of privilege and delight, finding your word like honey on our tongue, sweet as honeycomb, good, helpful, honorable, clean, as we learn to think your thoughts after you and are therefore drawn to your dear Son, in whose name we pray. Amen.